Hello, welcome to this webinar about Matrix ALM. Today I want to talk about requirement management. In a regulatory environment for medical devices, most often if you talk about requirements and verification, validation, what you get told is that you need to provide something like a V model. And the idea of a V model is actually that you have on the top left the market or user requirements, and then as you proceed in your project, you go down and you have finer and finer requirements. We have some system requirements, and then at some point, maybe software requirements. And once that is done, you do the implementation. And then you need to go up on the right-hand side to actually verify or prove that the different layers of your design work correctly. So you will have software tests, integration tests, and then in the top, you will have validation tests. And the validation should prove that the product does what it's supposed to do. So while you still might work agile, most auditors or notified bodies, even if you work agile, most auditors will actually require that you can produce something like that as form of documentation. And there's also clear requirements that you need to be have a traceability which proves that all of the design input and output has been documented and is verified or validated. So in Matrix, how you can handle that is that you can actually define different layers where you put your marketing requirements, and then the validation tests which go along. It could be one layer, and then the next layer could be some system requirements with verification tests. And then you do the same for software requirements or hardware requirements with software tests or hardware tests. But Matrix is completely configurable, so you can have more or less layers like this. And let's look at one layer in more detail. So in this layer, you have different items, and it's actually a complete tree, so you can use folders to structure your data. But each individual requirement, in this case a user or marketing requirement, has a unique ID, like here, MREQ1. It has a title, which is kind of a core of a requirement. And then usually there's a description field. And the description field that should detail in more detail how to actually, or what the requirement means. So it should help you to provide enough data to test it. Then in Matrix you can also have other fields with each item type, so it's also configurable. So for example here we have a drop down for a stakeholder, and that could be in this case maybe it's a normal patient, because that requirement is specifically for this kind of patient. But again, you can select and configure all of these details on the screen and all the metadata you need per category. So now what we do actually, whenever you make a change to your items in Matrix, you need to save it. That can happen automatically if you change your selection in the tree or by just clicking Ctrl S or the save button. And what this will do actually, it will save your edit together with a timestamp. So if I look at the history, what you can see is that I, as a user demo, at this date and time created a new version of your object, and then you can also see a comment, and that comment actually I entered when I started, when I logged in. And now of course, because we have all the different versions of your requirement, you can actually compare any two versions or even three of them to see what changed over time in your design. So in all of this audit log, you actually need to keep, and that's done completely automatically in Matrix. So then the other thing we do, if you go back at the V model here, you see that for our user requirements, we need to actually provide some tests to validate it. And in Matrix, that is done by the layer which you call val or validation tests here. And you can see that I already have a link which points me from my marketing or user requirement to a validation test. And if I click on that link, I can see my validation test, which is again the same thing. I've got an ID, a title. I've got in this example just a description box. In here I would basically write what is necessary for my validation test, what kind of hardware, software, is it a functional test, is it a regression test, so all kind of information which I might want to keep, or what do I need to do before I can start the test. And then, maybe more importantly, down here, you have your test steps, and that's usually an action, an expected outcome. So you would say the first stimuli is that a user logs into system, and user sees welcome screen. And then the next step could be user navigates to page XYZ, and then the expected outcome would be page XYZ is displayed. So here usually what you need to do is, in order to write good tests, is basically that you take actually validation tests out of a persona who needs to run the test. So the test should be written in such a way that, for example, if you have a patient doing it, they should be out of a view of a patient, not of an experienced engineer, but you should describe what the patient would do, because it's a validation test. And again, if I save, it will create a new version and store that object. So now if I go back actually to my requirement in here, I can also see the traceability from my marketing requirement to the test by clicking on that button here. So that marketing requirement links to the validation test and also to a system requirement, but I come back to it later. If I do now another change in here, so I just make that bold, for example, and then I'm gonna maybe put in an image. I won't put an image. Dun 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 dun. So I just made that bold. And if I save again, actually something will happen. Basically, I will get down here an indication that my validation test might be out of date because I changed the marketing requirement. So in order to fix that, I can just click on that, and if nothing changed, if it was just a spelling change, what I can do, I can just do a touch, and that will order things up to bring things in order again. So again, if you look at the meme model, there's lots of more layers, and these other layers could be, for example, system requirements like this. Again, you can order them in some tree structure. And along with the system requirements, usually go with system tests. And then if I go down one level, I would have software requirements. And here there's also, of course, standards like 62304, which tells you actually what kind of requirements you should think about and document. So all of that could go in here. So now actually the second point, which I wanted to quickly mention before I come to your question, is how to write these requirements. So if I look at a marketing requirement, how to write good marketing requirement is that you always have an actor, so who is it about, when you will have a verb, what is it doing, and an object, what is it, what is the object, the user doing with the object thingy. So for example here, the patient wants to gain mobility, patient, gain, and mobility. That's the three main items in that sentence. And then the description, you would, just to clarify for yourself, you can add more detail, but actually what you should add here is everything which makes it testable and verifiable. But what does it mean to gain mobility? Yeah, it could be patient wants to be able to leave the hospital day after surgery. Yeah. So that's something which can be tested. The patient wants to be able to travel. And like this, you can detail a bit more. What do you actually mean by gaining mobility? And that will later on help you to do your validation tests. If you come to the system requirement, again, a tip is to always start with the system. Or if your system has several subsystems, you start with the subsystem. So you say the app or the server or something else. And then what you should use is a word which is shall, which basically means it has to be like that. Another tip from my side is really only document all the requirements which are going to make or which will be in your first release or in your release in the next release of a medical device. It doesn't really make sense to have all these ideas with some priorities, can be, should be, whatever, because they just will make it more difficult to document one version of your device. So everything you do, you put in metrics. Everything you might want to do, you put in your issue management system, in your backlog, or in a completely different database. The reason for that is, first of all, as I said, it makes the documentation much more complex. And also the other thing is that it it will change very quickly. So as soon as you have your first device on the market, you will see that a user needs something else. They have completely different ideas of what you should do compared to what you thought in the beginning of your project. Or maybe there's different business opportunities or different other ideas which are actually more important. So if you have now ideas on what you want to do in 2 or 3 years, it's nice, but it should not be here in Matrix. So I see we already have some questions. Let me have a quick look. Yeah, I mean, one question which you have is how many requirements do I need? And essentially, what you need to document is everything you need to validate and verify your project. So you need to make sure that it works, and you need to make sure that it's safe. In terms of marketing requirements, my recommendation is to be really conservative, to keep it as low as possible. Reason for that is basically that actually nobody wants to use your device. I mean, that means, of course, it's very useful for people, but a physician, for example, he doesn't have time to spend working with very advanced features of your product. All he wants is, for example, to press one button or to do an operation, a surgery, as quickly as possible. So he doesn't want features, he wants to get his job done, and he wants to help the patient as quickly as possible. And the same for the patient. A patient is going to use your medical device, if it's for a patient, as long as he needs to be it, but it's not a hobby. So he doesn't want to make the perfect job, he wants to get healthy as quickly as possible. So that means that 2 main users you will have, they actually want the minimum of things. We really have just one wish: get someone or get myself healthy. But of course, what you need is all the requirements which make your device unique, and you need all the requirements which you tell people your device can do. So basically whatever you write in your intended use or in your marketing package. Also, if your device grows, if you make a second and third release, and you figure out that people ask you a lot about certain features, then over time you can add them to your marketing requirements. But for a first release, keep it simple. 10, 20 might be enough. For the system requirements, it's a little bit different. In here, it's important that you actually think about what will be implemented later on. So here it makes sense to put in with details. Again, you start with building blocks. You don't start a system requirement with a shape of a button in a user interface, but the system requirement is that the user can trigger a certain action. And then in the software requirements, you can go in more details. Yeah, and then a similar question is where to store, actually specifically for software, the software items, the software architecture, and things like that. For the software items, or also for the soup, for example, you can again create yourself some categories in matrix. For example, the software items, they could be organized in a tree structure, where you get all your software systems, and then you have items, sub-items, and then at the end of the tree you have your software units. So that kind of models 6 to 3 or 4 in terms of naming conventions. However, the architecture itself I would put in a document, because the architecture has quite a different meaning. It does not need to reference all the details about the items, but the important thing about the architecture is that it's used to explain how your system is safe, and for example, if you have two software systems, how, or two hardware systems, if you have two systems, how we are segregated to reduce the risk or to mitigate some risks. So that's actually the more important point of an architecture. So it's a lot of argumentation, a lot of pictures. So you don't store it in a tree format, but you just create a document in here. And in that document, you will have your architecture. So now another question is, how to actually do change management. For that, I can actually quickly go to a different project. So that's actually now our own development doc project. And if I go in here, I have a category which is called product changes. In here, what we keep is for each release, we keep all the changes. And then if I go to, let's say, new features in a release 2.2, I can immediately see what was changed in a certain release. So for example, in 2.2, we added a notification feature. And here I can actually see the text, which is part of our release notes. So we have some summary of our release notes somewhere. And in another place, we have a little bit more details with a little animated GIF in here. And these, again, are all the changes in the product. And what we usually do is we just link them on one side to the requirements, so to our user requirements. If it's a new, completely a new feature, usually it's going to be a new user requirement. Or if it's an improvement, if I select one in here, it's more often actually a change of a requirement on existing specification, so it will link to a different level. But that really depends on what it is. If it's a bug fix, usually the requirement and the specifications were correct, so it will actually link to a test case which needs to be improved, so that we don't, that the next time we test, we find the bug. So that is where the links are in one direction. And then if we actually, what we also do is we use the same item here from our release notes to link to a ticket in Jira. And in Jira, that's where we manage all the work. So that's completely outside. And also in here, we actually link to our source code. And that is quite nice, because for each release, we have all the changes in one place. We have the links in our design history file, which was updated accordingly. And then on the other hand, through the ticket, through the work which has been done, we also have the links to all the software changes. So there's really no gap, and everything is linked together. And next question is how to handle data which comes from standards or regulatory requirements. Here I can actually stay in the same project. So if I go all the way up here, in our case, we actually imported some regulatory requirements in here. In our case, we want to be Part 11 compliant, and that means we have certain requirements on what to do with electronic records, how to manage signatures and things like that. So that part here we actually just copied from a website from Part 11 and put it in here. And now what we did is we have the exact paragraph in here, the description from the website. And afterwards, we actually have two fields. Sometimes we have some gap analysis questions. So we ask ourselves, how can we figure out if we comply or not? Here it's actually quite easy. But what we have is actually our gap analysis comments and justification. So here we describe why we think we are compliant. We also put some pass-fail information. And then we actually link directly from that regulatory requirements to a different level. So it can go to top level marketing or user requirements, or it can go to some lower level system requirements or software requirements. Or if you want, you can also link directly to tests. So that depends a bit on what the requirements are. And of course, that works very well for requirements which are really for your product. It could be parts of 6061-1, which or -8, 6061-8 for alarms, which go in here, because they really impact your product. But it could also sometimes you have requirements from standards which are not really related to your product. So everything which is about processes. So 13485 for your processes doesn't really belong here because it has no direct impact on one requirement or one specification. So last but not least, what you can put in here is... Yes, and the nice thing about having your requirements here is that, first of all, while you're designing your product, you can already make sure that everything will be done correctly. So you know that by the time you do your testing, you comply to the standards. But it also allows you to very easily create something like a gap analysis, because you have all the traceability from the requirements of a standard to actually to the test results. So if I go here in the documents, I actually have an example here of our gap analysis, which is just a document we created from the data. And if I download it, you can see here we have our audit trail for each version, our electronic signatures, and then we have all these gap analysis questions. And what we do is we just basically show our justification and also if it's applicable or not. And if I go down a little bit, you can see here we have some requirements where we actually link some requirements from a standard where we link to our user requirements or system requirements. And then if I scroll down even further, we added a table where we show all the traceability. So we go from a requirement from a standard to our system marketing requirements, and then we go to the specification and tests. And if I now go even further, you can see here, actually for each of these requirements from the standard, we executed tests when it was executed and the test result. So, and that's just one nice document which you can create with that information. Okay, that's actually already all questions which we had. So thanks for joining. I hope it was useful. We have a couple of more webinars, so whenever you want, you can find them on Outlook or see in in our news if something new, or if you have a topic which interests you, just send us a short mail and we try to prepare one. Thanks for joining. Bye bye.